Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In my previous lecture, we started the phylum Platyhelminthes, in which we studied the class Cystodes. Then there were the next class, the Trematodes, and among the Trematodes, the important parasite is the Schistosoma haematobium that we will be discussing in our next lecture alone. In today's lecture, we will be starting the new phylum, that is the phylum Nemathelminthes or the nematodes. So what would be the learning outcomes of this lecture? The learning outcomes are the intestinal nematodes, and among the intestinal nematodes, the important intestinal nematodes that we will be discussing are the Ascaris lumbricoides, the Enterobius vermicularis, and the Ankylostoma duodenale. So briefly about the nematodes or the Nemathelminthes. So nematodes are basically the round worms with a cylindrical body and a complete digestive tract including the mouth and the anus. There are two separate sexes. The female is usually larger than the male, and the male has typically a coiled tail. So the medically important nematodes are characterized into two categories, the intestinal nematodes and the tissue nematodes. This classification is based on their location within the human body. So we will be discussing the intestinal nematodes today. So the intestinal nematodes of importance to man are the Ascaris lumbricoides, that is also referred to as the giant roundworm, the Enterobius vermicularis, that is referred to as the pinworm, the Ankylostoma duodenale, that is referred to as the hookworm. There are a few other intestinal nematodes including the Trichuris trichura, that is the whipworm, the Stronguloid stercolis, that is referred to as the small roundworm, and the Trichinella. These are not so important, so you will go through them by yourself. So basically, among these three intestinal helminthes, the Ascaris lumbricoids are transmitted by the ingestion of eggs, while the others are transmitted as the larval stage. So there are the two larval forms. The first and second stage larva, that is referred to as the rhabditiform larva, they are non-infectious and the feeding forms, while the third stage larva or the phylariform larva are the infectious or the non-feeding forms. So firstly, we will be discussing the Ascaris lumbricoids. The geographical distribution of Ascaris lumbricoids is worldwide, especially in the tropical areas. The habitat is that the adult worm lives in the small intestine of man. Now coming to the morphology, it is the largest the intestinal nematode, that is the giant roundworm. It is round and it tapers at both ends, and it is light brown to pink in color and resembles an earthworm. The females are longer than the males. So this is the characteristic morphology of the Ascaris lumbricoids, the adult Ascaris worm with tapered ends, and the Ascaris lumbricoids, the adult male and the female. The female is longer as compared to the males. Now coming to the morphology of the Ascaris lumbricoids eggs. The eggs are round to oval in shape, approximately 40 to 70 micrometer by 30 to 50 micrometer. And the egg contains the unsegmented ovum with a clear crescenteric zone at each pole, which is surrounded by a thick, smooth, translucent shell with an outer albuminous coat, which is thrown into pieces or the rugosities. So this is the characteristic morphology of the Ascaris lumbricoid egg. The unsegmented ovum you can very well appreciate in the middle, and then a clear concentric zone between the translucent shell and the unsegmented ovum, and the outer albuminous coat which is thrown into the rugosities. So this is the characteristic diagnostic stage of the Ascaris lumbricoids within the stools. Now this is the morphology of the egg in the unfertilized form on the left side and the fertilized egg on the right side. So In the second figure, in the lower figure, the egg is containing the larva, which will be infective if it is ingested. The Scaris lumbricoides are infective when they are ingested in the form of egg. Now the life cycle. All the nematodes' life cycle have one single thing in common. They pass the life cycle in only one host. No intermediate host is required. So the definitive host is the man. The eggs are excreted within the feces of the man, and under suitable conditions, the infective larvae, that is the rigidiform larvae, are formed within the egg. And when these egg contaminated food or water is accidentally taken by the man, the infection occurs. So the infection occurs by ingestion of food contaminated with infective eggs, which hatch in the upper small intestine. Before hatching, the larva undergoes a process that is referred to as the molting. The larva then penetrates the intestinal wall and enters the venules and lymphatics, and via the portal circulation, the larva ultimately reaches through the right heart, and through the pulmonary vessels, it ultimately reaches to the lung and then breaks through the capillary wall and enters the alveoli. So within the lung, they molt twice and ascend through the bronchi, the trachea, the larynx, the pharynx, and then they are swallowed again to reach the small intestine, where the fourth molting takes place and they grow into the adult form. So within the small intestine, the fertilization or the mating process occurs and the females start laying eggs. So this is the figure. On the left side, the larva is seen hatching from the egg, and on the right side, the larva is seen within the section of the lung. So this is the characteristic life cycle of the Scaris lumbricoids, and it shows characteristically the egg that is excreted within the feces, and which ultimately after embryonation, the rigidiform larva develops within the egg, which is the infective form. The unsegmented ovum is released into the external environment, and where the embryonation takes place, and finally the rigidiform larva develops into the egg, and when it is ingested by the man, it reaches the small intestine, and from where it, through the portal circulation, through the liver, through the right heart, it ultimately reaches into the lungs and into the alveoli, from where it is cuffed up into the trachea, the pharynx, and then swallowed again to reach the small intestine of man, where the adult form develops, including the male and the female roundworms. The females are longer as compared to the males. The fertilization and the mating process then occurs within the small intestine, and the females start laying the eggs, which are passed into the stools, and ultimately the life cycle continues. Now coming to the pathogenicity, the symptoms are related to the worm burden. 10 to 20 worms may go unnoticed except in the routine stool examination. The commonest complaint is the vague abdominal pain, and in more severe cases, the patient may experience listlessness, the weight loss, the anorexia, distended abdomen, intermittent loose stool, and occasional vomiting. So during the pulmonary stage, when the larvae are present within the lung, the person may experience the brief period of cough, the wheezing, the dyspnea, and the substernal discomfort. And these symptoms are due to the physical presence of worm within the lungs. Now coming to the lab diagnosis, the diagnosis is based on the identification of eggs within the saline and the iodine preparations of stool under the microscope. Occult blood in the stool is frequent. So the prophylaxis is the good hygiene, which is the characteristic prophylactic measure. And the drug of choice are the albendazole, the mebendazole, and the ivermectin. And the mebendazole 200 mg for adults and 100 mg for children for 3 days is effective. So here we come to an end of Scaris lumbricoids. The next parasite, Ankylostoma duodenale. and the Nicator americans that are referred to as the hookworms. So the geographical distribution is worldwide, especially in the tropical and the subtropical areas. The habitat is the same, the small intestine of man. The morphology, the adult worm is reddish brown in color, small and cylindrical, and the anterior end of the worm bears the teeth and is bent slightly. Therefore, it is also referred to as the hookworm. So this is the characteristic morphology of the adult male and female of Ankylostoma duodenalis, showing the characteristic rounded or hook shape interior end and its characteristic name, the hookworm. Now the morphology of the eggs. The eggs are oval in shape, 60 by 40 micrometers. They are colorless and are surrounded by a transparent haline shell membrane, as you can very well appreciate in the bottom two figures, the translucent or the transparent haline shell membrane. They contain a segmented ovum that is segmented into 2 to 8 cells, and there is a clear space between the egg shell and the segmented ovum. Now coming to the life cycle, the worm passes its life cycle in only one host, that is the definitive host, the man. No intermediate host is required. The eggs are passed in the pieces, and from each egg a reptiliform larva hatches, and first molting takes place by the reptiliform larva, and it changes into phylariform larva, which is the infective form. As I already mentioned, that these parasites, except the Ascaris lumbricoides, are transmitted and are infectious in their larval form, and the reptiliform larva is the feeding form and it is non-infectious, and the phylariform larva is the non-feeding or the infectious form. So the esophagus is long as compared with the length in the phylariform larva. The phylariform larva penetrates the skin of man in majority of cases on the foot or the leg. So during the penetration, the second molting takes place. So this is the characteristic morphology of the hookworm phylariform larva. So the rest of the life cycle is same, that it enters the venules and lymphatics, and through the blood they are carried to the right heart, and through the pulmonary vessels reach the lung, where they break the capillary wall to enter the alveoli. From the alveoli, they ascend through the bronchi, trachea, larynx, pharynx, and are swallowed again to reach the esophagus, where the third molting takes place. And ultimately, they reach the small intestine, where the fourth molting takes place, and they develop into adult female and male. And after fertilization, the females start laying the eggs. So this is the characteristic life cycle of the Ankylostoma duodenale. The eggs, the segmented eggs are excreted within the feces, and then within the soil the egg form the reptiliform larva, and then the infective phylariform larva, and from where the phylariform larva penetrates the skin of man, and then the larva migrates through the lung and cause pneumonia, and then after the person coughs up from the lung to the trachea to the pharynx and ultimately to the esophagus, where the third molting takes place, the larval stage reaches the small intestine, where it matures into the adult male and female, and then the fertilization occurs and the females start laying the eggs, and then the eggs are excreted within the human feces and the life cycle continues. So now the pathogenicity. At the site of penetration into the lung, they causes the characteristic appearance of erythema, the macules and papules, that is commonly referred to as the ground itch. Then they also cause the pulmonary bronchitis, pneumonitis, and they are the important cause of eosinophilia. Then anorexia, epigastric pain, and the gastrointestinal hemorrhage, hypoproteinemia, edema, and the cardiac failure. The characteristic complication of ankylostoma duodenale infection is the iron deficiency anemia, because each parasite that attaches to the intestinal mucosa draws about 0.1 ml to 0.3 ml of blood per day. So the severity of anemia depends upon the worm load. So the diagnosis is made by identification of the hookworm eggs within the fresh and the preserved pieces. Then occult blood in the stool is frequent and eosinophilia is typical. So good hygiene, disposing of sewage properly and wearing shoes to prevent the penetration of larvae are the effective preventive measures. The treatment is the same, the albendazole, metbendazole or the parenteral pemoate. And the dose is the same, 200 mg for adults and 100 mg for children for 3 days, and it is effective. So here we come to an end of ankylostoma duodenale. Now we will be starting the last intestinal and important intestinal nematode, the Enterobius vermicularis or the pinworm. The geographical distribution of Enterobius vermicularis is worldwide, and the adult worm lives in the lower ileum, cecum and the colon of man. And this infection is common in the children under 12 years of age. And the morphology is that the female worm measures approximately 0.5 mm and the male is smaller as compared to the female. Now coming to the morphology, the eggs are 60 micrometers to 27 micrometers. They are ovoid in shape, but they are asymmetrically flat on one side, that is the D-shaped morphology. Now the life cycle, man is the only host, and infection occurs when the eggs are ingested from the environment with food or by hand-to-mouth contact. The larvae hatch in the duodenum and reach adolescent stage in the jejunum and the upper ileum, and the adult forms descend into the lower ileum, cecum and the colon and live there. The gravid females containing more than 10,000 eggs migrate at night to the perianal region and deposit their eggs there. And there the eggs mature in an oxygenated moist environment, and they are infectious 3 to 4 hours later. So man-to-man contact and auto-infection are common. So the reinfection can occur if they are carried to the mouth by the fingers after scratching the itching skin. So this is the characteristic life cycle of the Enterobius vermicularis. As you can see, at stage 1, the eggs on the perianal folds, the larvae inside the eggs mature within 4 to 6 hours. So this is the survival of eggs in the environment. So these eggs are basically laid on the perianal skin. And within the eggs, embryonated eggs, the larval stage form and it is infectious to the man. So the larva hatch in the small intestine into an adult stage, that is the adult female and male. The fertilization takes place within the colon, and the female at night, the gravid female migrate to the perianal skin and lays the eggs there. And from there, the eggs after scratching the perianal skin are transmitted again to the men, and the life cycle continues. So the most common symptom is the perianal, perineal and the vaginal pruritus or the irritation that is caused by the female migration. The itching results in insomnia and restlessness, and in some cases gastrointestinal symptoms, that is the pain, nausea and vomiting, may develop. The diagnosis is made by finding the adult worm or the eggs in the perianal area, particularly at night, through the scotch tape technique or the pinworm pedal. So unlike those of other intestinal nematodes, the eggs are not found within the stools. The small whitish adult forms can be found in stools or near the anus of the diaper children. No serological tests are available for diagnosis. Prophylaxis are the bedding and underclothing must be sanitized between the two treatment doses that are given below, and personal cleanliness provide the most effective method of prevention, that is the washing hands when preparing food and washing the bed sheets, towels, diapers and clothing to remove eggs. The treatment of choice is albendazole, mebendazole or pyrantel pemoate. The drug kills the adult worms in the colon but not the eggs, so retreatment in 2 weeks is suggested. So the two doses, 10 mg per kg, maximum of 1 gram each of pyrantel pemoate 2 weeks apart gives a very high cure rate. Mebendazole is an alternative treatment. Thank you so much. In the next lecture, we will be discussing the tissue nematodes and the trematodes.